What is going on, my American friends? It is I, King T'Challa, reporting live from the nation of Wakanda. And today we will cover the adaptation to aerobic and anaerobic training in the body. Now I'm playing. What's up, y'all? It's Professor Kirk here, back with another video. Today we're going to be going over the adaptations to aerobic and anaerobic training. Keep in mind, these videos are just broad overviews of the major concepts and ideas that you'll need to understand for the course. And if you have any questions, please feel free to reach out to your professor or your graduate student. So, let's get into it. So, majority of this video is going to be over aerobic training. Anaerobic we'll get into the end, but it's not as in-depth, all right? So, with aerobic training, first thing that we're going to see is an increase in cardiorespiratory endurance. So, what does that mean, Professor Kirk? Well, that literally means that we're going to have a more efficient interplay between the heart and the blood and the lungs and the various components that compose that, such as alveoli, bronchioli, all that type of stuff, right? So basically, the heart and the lung get along real well and when we experience increases in cardiorespiratory endurance. Now, what this means is we might have an increase in heart size, and this can be due to an increase in the left ventricle. If you remember from a few lectures ago, we were talking about how when you're pumping blood to the body, the left ventricle is responsible for pumping the blood to the periphery of the body. By periphery, we mean hands, feet, all that other good stuff, right? So as a result, when this endurance goes up, that left ventricle will get stronger. And as it gets stronger, we'll see an increase in heart size as well as an increase in something called stroke volume. Now, as an increase in stroke volume, and we see an increase in heart size, as a result, that stroke volume is going up. Even if our heart rate is steady, we know that the equation for cardiac output is stroke volume times heart rate. So if our heart rate goes up, if our stroke volume goes up and our heart rate kind of stays the same, we know that the value will increase, meaning that we have a greater cardiac output, okay, which is Q. So stroke volume goes up, heart rate increases as you exercise, and cardiac output increases moreover. Now, something that we do see in people who train more versus people who don't train at all is a decrease in something called blood pressure, which we talked about a few videos ago as well. Now, the reason that you see this drop in blood pressure is it's merely because the heart does not have a need to pump as forcefully as it usually would once it's been trained for a specific activity. So let's say if we've been running 5Ks, the first 5K we ran with no training was horrible. But then after we ran a couple of training and stuff like that, it's a lot easier. And as a result, the heart won't need to push as much, it won't struggle to push as much blood through as forcefully. It's a lot more efficient process. And as a result, that blood pressure you will see a reduction in that value. So we'll move on to the next point. There are no significant changes in your maximal heart rate. That meaning that whatever your max heart rate is at a certain age, usually between whatever it is at the age of 20, that's usually the highest that it will get for the majority of your life. But what we do see is we see an increase in faster recovery. So you see people who run track, after they run 100 meter dash for the very first time, they're exhausted. They're like, and then like that for like 2 minutes, right? But then after they've been doing that a couple times for a few years and such, the recovery might be like 45 seconds tops or whatever. And that's what we mean by faster recovery. And move on to the next point, we see that we have an increase in blood flow to the active muscles. So one of the reasons why we have an increase in this blood flow to active muscles is because we have an increase in the actual capillaries that are traveling to those muscles. This process is known as angiogenesis. That's not something that you're going to know, but it's a fancy term in case you're curious about it. So this is what our vessels look like before we started training, pre-training, right? But after we've been going for about usually 3 months, this is what they look like after. The color change is negligible, so don't pay attention to that. But what you see is a greater branching, and these are going to the exact same muscles. And they're more so branched and more systematic in structure when they need to deliver blood to those tissues. And they do that because we've been training. But we also see an increase in the blood volume as a whole. So what I mean by that is you see an increase like in plasma. You might see an increase in the, plasma is composed of water. Yeah, let's just go with plasma for the sake of this class. You'll see an increase in plasma, but you also see an increase in the actual blood volume moreover. Now, what you won't see usually is an increase in hematocrit, which is the percent of, or the amount of blood, red blood cells that are actually within the blood. So that's what you need to know for the first portion of this lecture. Moving on into respiratory, what we see is that submaximal intensity, our ventilation definitely, which is, let me start over. Okay, we see a decrease in ventilation at submaximal intensity. So what that means is you don't need to breathe as hard when you're performing a submaximal exercise. So if I'm, well not submaximal exercise, when you're performing at submaximal intensity.
So usually you're breathing super hard if you're just doing like a jumping jack or something, right? If for the very first time. But after you've done it for a good amount of time, you see a decrease in this ventilation rate. Now, over time, what you will see is that with perfusion on the flip side, which goes hand in hand with ventilation, perfusion is just the exchange of oxygen between the muscle tissues and the blood that is in the body, all right? So we see that whenever we're exercising, the blood is going through our hearts, our lungs, deoxygenated it and coming back out, right? So this is unchanged except when at maximal intensity. At maximal intensity, the perfusion rate is better. Like it's more efficient. We're delivering more oxygen to the tissues more efficiently. But when it's anything below maximal intensity, we don't really see any changes in that, right? So moving on from respiratory into the muscle, what we see in the muscle is that we have an increase in mitochondria. And this is important, especially for aerobic respiration, because it relies pretty much solely on this mitochondria, because the mitochondria is where the oxidative phosphorylation and electron transport chain, all that stuff, good stuff occurs, right? But specifically within this mitochondria, we don't just see an increase in them as a whole. What we see within the mitochondria is this increase in this enzyme, I think it's called cytochrome C reductase. Yeah, that's the name for it. AKA complex 4, right? So with this increase in this complex 4, what this does is it's just able to shuttle protons more efficiently and get us more ATP and get us, in a cascade of events, more oxygen and more energy, right? So therefore, our muscles can perform more activity, okay? Now, we see the similar effects of long-term cardiorespiratory endurance training when we perform something called high-intensity interval training, aka known as HIIT. So HIIT is very effective because it requires less time, but you usually see similar results. Now, I'm not saying after you do a month of HIIT, will it equate to you doing the same month of the same amount of running for a marathon in a month? No, it won't. The person who's been running for a who's been training for a marathon for a month versus the person who's been doing HIIT for a month will obviously have greater cardiorespiratory endurance. However, that person who has been performing HIIT will still have pretty efficient cardiorespiratory endurance and may be able to keep up depending on how hard they've been training and such. But that's just what you'll need to understand for the muscular aspects of this adaptation to the aerobic training. Now, what we see in the actual metabolism is that in regards to fatigue and exhaustion, is the first point we're going to see is the lactate threshold is going to decrease or increase how you're looking at it. So what I mean by that is it's going to take us longer for the buildup of lactate to actually affect us. So we'll see a decrease in production and an increase in clearance. That means less is made and more is cleared out, right? But even along with that, what we see is a decrease in respiratory exchange ratio, which affects the lactate threshold. Now, with this respiratory exchange ratio, we talked a few videos ago about this is just the volume of total carbon dioxide produced divided by the total volume of oxygen produced. So we actually see a decrease in this actual ratio. In relation to that, what we see is an increase in the max O2 that can be uptaken. So what that means is usually, let's say you've been running or training for 6 months or something like that, right? Your increased max VO2 can get better, is what we're saying, by 15% to 20%, give or take, right? Now, however, on the flip side, your resting at submaximal intensity is relatively unchanged. So that means like your VO2 when you're doing something that's a submaximal activity, or if you're just resting, it's not going to really fluctuate at all, even if you have an increase in your maximal VO2 uptake. Move on to the next point. When we see performance can increase after VO2 plateaus. And this is going to be kind of confusing to students, so you're not going to really need to understand the mechanism behind this. But what you really want to understand is that your performance can be greatly altered or be greatly increased, even if your VO2 has reached its maximum height. So by that, I mean, I'm like, let's say if we got a VO2, let's say 200 liters or something like that, right? Which is a lot. let's say you have a VO2 of 200 liters, and let's say you start running up the hill for the first time, or training up hills for the first time. It's really hard, right? Let's say over time that you get better at it, right? And as you get better, as you were able to move up that hill more quickly and efficiently, that doesn't necessarily mean that your VO2 is going to change if you have already reached its maximal capacity. So if you already been training for 12 to 18 months prior to this, and you never ran up hills, but you're running up hills now, and you're taking a few days out of your week to run up these hills, over time, you will be able to do this more efficiently without changing your VO2 max. And the last two points we're getting to here are sex. So sex is in regards to like men and women and such. What we see in sex is that usually women have a lesser, I guess the word I'm looking for, in untrained females, that is, have a lower VO2 max in comparison to males. However, trained females, their VO2 max is pretty close to what males can get. So basically, all I'm saying is that women starting off, they don't have the same VO2 max capacities on average as men do, which is more or less understandable. However, when trained, women can run just as far, just as hard, just as long as any man can. Now, moving kind of back into the actual metabolism of these, of the, I guess, glycolysis and all this other stuff, what we see is that we have an increase in these things called glycolytic enzymes, the things that we covered in the second chapter of this course. But we also see that the ATP phosphocreatine system is unchanged. So this is important just because it makes things, it makes the process for ATP to be generated a lot easier. And this is not as important, but it is interesting to note that it doesn't change at all. So that might be like a trick question that your professor might throw out there for you, right? And there are a few other things that I'm going to talk about that aren't on here. The first thing is that endurance training is critical for endurance-based events, which is pretty obvious. If you're doing marathons, you need to practice and run marathons pretty frequently if you want to increase your speed and your overall performance, right? Now, something else that is super interesting is we see in anaerobic training is changes in anaerobic power and capacity, right? So anaerobic power capacity increases with training. Specifically, if we're looking at it from a muscular standpoint, in type 1-2A fibers and type 1-2X fibers, we see increases in their cross-sectional area. Now, in type 1 fibers, in type 1's cross-sectional area, what we see is an increase, but to a lesser extent. So they're not increasing as much as the type 2A and the type 2X fibers. Now, for the last point that you want to get to know for the adaptions in muscular tissue for this anaerobic training is that we see a decrease in the actual percent of type 1 fibers in relation to the percent of type 2 fibers, right? Which is something I just stated. But with those type 2 fibers, we talked about a few videos ago, is I think the type 2A will, the type 2X will become more like the type 2A over time. I believe that's what I said in the last video. Don't quote me on that. Definitely go back and check it out. Oh, wow. My camera's falling. All right, folks. Well, if you have any questions, feel free to let me know. Sorry about that. And yeah, I hope that was helpful.